Hello everyone, this is Akshay and in this video I'll be covering debouncing in JavaScript. Debouncing is not just a very important interview question, but it is also very helpful while you are developing web apps. Majorly, when you are developing a customer facing web app, you need to be very performant. Your website should not freeze anytime while user is doing anything on the browser. I have used this concept a lot of times in my career all across while developing a lot of web apps, and it is quite useful not just for the interviews but in real life scenarios as well. Like, I find a lot of scenarios where I can use this concept and improve the performance of the web page. I'll go step by step in this videos and I won't directly jump onto what debouncing is and what is the definition of debouncing, but I will cover the scenarios where you can apply debouncing and how it is very useful. I'll be coding directly from scratch so that if you are asked to code anytime in the interviews, you can directly start it from there. And I will also share my interview experience with Flipkart, where I was asked this same question and a lot of companies also ask this question. So without wasting any more time, let's explore debouncing. When I was giving interview for Flipkart, so the interviewer asked me to develop a search bar just like the same over here on flipkart.com website. So it auto suggests you a lot of things according to the search query what you type in. So if I type in laptop, so what happens is it makes an API call and gets the search results and feeds to this list. And if you type in more, suppose laptop, Lenovo, then again more API calls are made and the results are fetched from the network. But the important thing to notice is, so let me clear all the network calls first of all. So the important thing to notice over here is it does not make API call for each and every keystroke event. So let's see one more example. So suppose I want to search for school bags. So it just made two API calls. The first one was when I typed school and the second one was when I completely typed school bags. So it was because I gave a pause between school and school bags. So once I gave a pause at school, it made an API call and got me. And once I completed with school bags, it again made an API calls and get me the results over here. You can see these responses and these suggestions, what it is suggesting. So we need to implement this type of functionality onto our own search bar. So how will we do it? So here is when the debounce functionality comes into picture. Develop the same functionality. So I'm starting from scratch so that you get a better idea of how to approach this question in interviews and directly from scratch. So let's start. So I have this basic HTML page. In this, we'll create an input box first of all. So the on key up in this input will call a method get data. This get data method will get the data from the server or hit an API and get the data and feeds in, like can do whatever you want to. So let's try to implement this get data in our JavaScript file. So let's say we have a function get data, which calls an API and gets data. So we can implement our logic of fetching, making a network call and getting the data and according to the search queries. So that all we can do. So for now we can mock that thing and we just write a console log over here. So fetching data. So something like this. So let's try to see this on the browser once. So if we refresh the page, we have this search bar over here, what we created, and on key up events, it is printing fetching data again and again. So to distinguish between the different events, let's pass some counter or something to clearly visualize this, so that we get different events over here. Yeah, so when I typed Akshay in this input box,
So I fired 6 events. So that means our API would have been called 6 times while typing Akshay. So what we want to try to achieve is, so once I pause while typing, then only this API call should be made. To solve our problem of this calling getData method again and again, we should come up with some better function which should actually do some magic onto our getData method. So what should be the magic over here? So it should do some magic over getData and don't make it call again and again on each and every keystroke. Rather, it should only call when the user is paused while typing. So what do I mean to say is, suppose if I take an example of 300 milliseconds. So if only the difference of time between two key presses is greater than 300 milliseconds, then only call getData method, or then only fetch the results from the API. So I will repeat, listen to it carefully. So only do some magic and only call getData method when the difference of time between the two key press events is greater than 300 milliseconds or is 300 milliseconds. So let's try to write our do some magic method. One thing about this function I definitely know is that it will return me a function again. Let's make an anonymous function. So this function will be the better function now after we call do some magic and pass getData and 300 over here. And this better function would be called on the onKeyUp instead of our traditional getData method, which was called again and again. So this do some magic takes two arguments, which is a function getData in our case right now and a delay. So this delay is basically the delay between the two key press events what we are talking about. So instead of calling this function which is getData over here directly, what we will do, we will wait for certain time, which is 300 right now in this case, or the delay, and after that we'll call that function. Something like this. The reason to do this is because we are trying to listen up for the delay or 300 milliseconds and check whether any other keystroke is being pressed between this 300 milliseconds since this method. And then if there is no keystroke between that 300 millisecond delay, then directly call this method. That can be achieved by using set timeout over here. So if this delay goes 300 milliseconds, then the getData will be called. So calling this getData over here won't be like this, but rather we'll use an apply to fix our this variables and the context. So to achieve that, we'll have to do something like maintaining the context over here, which is the this, and also the arguments, if there are some arguments over here. So these are just basic things which are required to keep a check that the environment or the lexical scope where this function is running is correct and the same getData method is called with the same arguments if it had. So in this site set timeout, we are calling this getData method and we are waiting for this delay of 300 milliseconds. And if again a keystroke happened, then we should stop calling this method. So how can we do that? So to stop calling that method, we should somehow clear this timeout. So to clear this timeout, we should first store this timeout into some variable. Let's call it as timer. So this timer now has this set timeout, which when expires this delay of 300 milliseconds will call this getData method. But if a keystrokes occur between that time, so we have to clear this timeout. So let's try to understand this from the beginning. So what will happen is when I am typing inside my search box, this better function will be called on each and every key press event. And that will call do some magic method and will return us a function which will do some processing like this. So we will have a lot of copies of this function running and a lot of timer created in each and every method call. So these timer created will be calling the getData method over here after each and every 300 seconds is passed. So we will have to come up with some strategy of clearing this set timeout or this timer whenever a new function call is being made. Suppose whenever a new function call is being made and 300 milliseconds has not passed. So we'll do that thing over here. So not interval, set timeout, and we'll clear this timer. So this timer, if I initialize over here, couldn't be cleared. So we should initialize this timer even outside our method. And fix this error. So try to observe this code once again. So let's recap what I did till now, everything from the starting. So now what we are trying to do is we are trying to call the better function instead of get data on our on key press event. So this better function will be called every time each and every keystroke is pressed, and it will return us a copy of this function, which will start a timer of a delay of 300 milliseconds and will call this getData method if we don't clear the interval or we don't clear the timeout before this 300 milliseconds is passed. So let's see this in action. So I'm refreshing the page and I'm suppose in this search box, I am searching for watches or some laptops. Let's take it as laptops. So if you see, I was typing slowly and it made a lot of network calls. So what if I type very fast? So let's try it once. So if I am searching for school bags. So see, instead of making 1, 2, 3, 4, this 10 or 12 network calls, it just made 3 network calls. So that is what we are trying to achieve and optimize our performance. So whenever I am pausing while typing of black color, it is making very less number of network calls what it could have made while we were binding that get data onto our on key press event. So this was one of the case where this debouncing can be used. So the magic which do some magic function has did over here is known as debouncing, or we'll call this as a debounce method. So this is what the debounce function is. So debounce function takes two arguments, a function and a delay, and does not let this function make unnecessarily calls again and again, and will only make a call if the difference between the time interval between two function calls is greater than this delay. This debounce method is very useful, and this is one place where we can apply this concept. There are a lot of other places where we can apply this method and optimize performance of our web page. So suppose if we had to make an API call on scroll event, or suppose we are trying to implement a lazy loading or any sort of that thing, and we are trying to implement a function or we are calling a function on the scroll event. The scroll events is triggered a lot of times when you are scrolling a web page. So you can't make an API call or any other functionalities on that many time. That will probably freeze your browser. So the better way to do is to keep it behind the debounce method So it is debounce method takes a method and then returns you again a method which is a better method than what it was. So this was all about debounce method, and you can even use it on the resize of the window if you are trying to do that, and a lot of other places. So this was all about the debounce method, and hope you have understood it. And yeah, that's all for the code, and thank you.
So that was all about debouncing. There is one more concept of throttling, which is quite similar to what debouncing is, but it is not that often used and asked as debouncing. So comment down below if you want video for throttling as well. And if there are a lot of people commenting, then I would probably come up with a video of throttling as well. Apart from this, in my upcoming videos, I will also be coming up with more JavaScript core concepts and more interview questions and experiences. So stay subscribed to my channel and learn something new every day. And if you have any questions or suggestions for me, or if you want me to cover any specific topic, then directly reach out to me on LinkedIn, Facebook, or just directly comment down in this video, and I would be happy to help you. That's all for now. Thanks for watching.